welcome, friends, to another edition of TiffinCast. I'm your host, Seishu, and today I am extremely honored to have Craig Lamere, portrait photographer. We finally got you here, buddy. It's nice to connect on Skype. I know this is your second time on Skype ever, and the connection's fantastic. Craig, I've followed your work on Facebook. I've studied your photographs intensely. They're just incredible. They're portraits that should really hang on in museum walls, to be honest with you. I think the way you light is special. I think the way you post-process is very special. So let's talk about you. Let's talk about how you began, and let's talk about your location. Where are you located?
I'm located in a small town in Idaho called Pocatello, Idaho. It's about 2 hours from Salt Lake City and 3 hours away from Boise, Idaho.
Excellent. Wow. And that's family? That's where family is, I'm assuming?
Yeah, I've grown up here my whole life. You know, after high school, I thought I would venture out, and I went to California for a while and then Utah for a while, but I ended up coming back home. And I love Idaho.
There's definitely, I mean, it's a spectacular state. I mean, it's a beautiful state, for sure. Although it's far from where you think most of your clients are. Most of your models probably don't live in Idaho, right? And I'm assuming you travel to find models and locations and some things like that.
Well, see, now that's the crazy thing, which is a huge misnomer. You know, if you look at my portfolio, probably 95 or more percent of the models, you know, so-called models in my portfolio are girls from Idaho.
Okay.
You know, they're girls from within a 50 to 70 mile radius of me.
Oh, wonderful. That's great.
We have some pretty hot girls here.
tell me a little bit about your beginnings. How did you even get your start in photography?
Well, I'll do it really quickly.
Sure. No, take your time.
So when I was in college, I actually I went to school. I thought I was going to be an English professor. You know, I thought I was going to write books and chase college girls my whole life. And I really kind of got disenchanted with the whole thing. And I needed a spare job. And so my friend Brooks Davis, he was a graphic artist at the college. And he said, "Hey, I know you need a job. Just go apply for this job." I said, I have no idea about graphics. He goes, "It doesn't matter. Just apply for it. You'll get it." And I'm like, "Okay, sounds good." So I went up, filled out the application. And then they said, "Okay, you know, now you have to take your practical test." And I said, "Not a problem." So we go in his room. Brooks closes the door, and he did it for me. And so then, obviously, I got the job. And so that was my introduction into Photoshop. And this was like back in Photoshop 3 days. And so it was really on the job training, and that's how I learned how to edit. And so when I got done with school, I ended up, after a few jobs, going into commercial insurance. And I hated it more than anything. Like, it was the worst ever. But
not your calling, I can tell.
No. Well, but you know, and I just made a lot of money, and so it was hard to walk away from all that money. Sure. And my wife at the time was a RN, and so then Stacy was going to go back to school and get her nurse practitioner's license. And I told her, I said, "All right, Stace, when you're done. I'm out of insurance." And I didn't know what I was going to do. Mm-hmm. I really, honestly, I could care less what I was going to do. I was done. And so about that time, when she was going to go back to school, Costco opened in our town. And so it's just kind of like I decided I'm just going to buy a little camera. So I bought a Rebel, spent about $1,000 on a little kit, and I just started taking pictures. And it just, you know, pretty much took over everything. And so at the time, like I tell everyone, I live in this little fantasy world. Like I daydream all the time. And so I really play out these little stories of how my life's going to end up. And at the time, the fantasy was, like, all I would do was golf. Like, I would literally on the weekends be on the course before the clubhouse was open, and I'd be the last one off the course. And in my head, this was preparation for my next career, which was going to be on the senior PGA tour. And I really believed that in my head.
All right.
And so I had bought this really cool golf cart. Like, I put big fat tires on it with big pimped out wheels and a big stereo in it, and it was awesome. And so I was shooting pictures, and I got on the internet, and I bought a used 70 to 200 lens. And I was like, crap, man, this lens is so much nicer than my whole kit. And at the time, that was when the 5D Mark II came out. And so what I did was I was like, I have to make a choice. I can either pretend to be a golfer, or I could really go after what I think could be good. Mm-hmm. And so I just told myself, and I could afford both if I wanted, but it was really a thing about making a decision.
Right.
And I said, okay. So I sold my golf cart and I bought that camera body. And that was it. And that was the turning point for me, to where I decided that that's what I was going to do with my life. And so I took about a year. I did nothing but shoot, just constantly shoot, you know. And
what were you shooting? What were you shooting, though, at that point?
Well, when I first started, I'm just like everybody, you know. First, I shot rocks, and then I shot landscapes, and then I got brave and shot animals, and then I started shooting people. And then I pissed off all my friends, and my wife especially, like, she was having no more of getting her picture taken, like, this was done.
Yeah.
And that's when it hit me, is when I just found portraiture. You know, I just realized through all the things that I was shooting that I really liked shooting people.
Indeed. But why specifically portraiture and not, let's say, business pictures or weddings, for, you know?
Well, okay, well, you know, I'm like everybody else. And this is the craziest thing about photography. And this, and like when I talk, these are just my own little assessments of things, of the things that I see and I've observed. But it's so crazy to me, because I was the same way. Like, I thought that I was going to, you know, weddings were the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
You can make a lot of money on them. But it's like the dumbest thing ever. Like, every new shooter, it seems like, wants to go from shooting a rock to shooting someone's wedding. And to me, and I always tell people, I say, you know what that's like? That's like taking the training wheels off your pedal bike and then buying a Ferrari. Like, you've made that big a leap. Like, it's the dumbest thing in the world that you could do, to think that you're going to go shoot someone's wedding. And, but, you know, everyone has to go through it.
Right.
And so I guess to answer your question was, I'm really, this is crazy. Like, I'm such a face freak. Like, you know, when I see women, you know, the first thing I see is eyes and hair, and sometimes hair more than eyes. And I've always been drawn to that. And then, you know, I see all the other stuff that everyone else sees. But really, that's what I look at, and that's what draws me. And so that's what I just was drawn to shoot, was faces, because they're very interesting to me.
Indeed. One of the things that distinguishes your work from other photographers who do also portraits is the way you light. Tell us a little bit about how you learn to light, and what is it that you do when you first have somebody in front of you? What is it that you're looking for?
Well, in the beginning, you know, like I said, I was just like everyone else. You know, I just shot, you know, I would just point and shoot and didn't really know what was going on. And, you know, I'd get some good pictures, and some look different than others. And, so I would get on, like how I learned how to light was basically, after I kept getting doors slammed in my face all day, I would go to Barnes & Noble and I would read books, and I would get on YouTube and I'd look at everything I could find. And I couldn't pinpoint when it happened, but it obviously did, was I came across light patterns, you know, and then they started to make sense to me, because everything I do is super light pattern driven. Like I'm a real purist. I believe that if you can understand those patterns, you can create anything you want.
Mm-hmm.
And so the more I would study them and the more I would practice them, the more I started to, like, see the light, if that makes sense.
Sure.
You know, that's how it is right now. Like, you know, when I'm going to shoot someone, and I tell everyone this, like I'm a big believer of you should have already seen your image in your head before you ever hit the button. Like when I meet my clients, just by the way they look, by mm-hmm. the way, you know, the things that they've talked about, the clothing they're going to wear, I already know how to light them. I know what's going to fit them, right. You know? And so that's kind of how I go about all my shoots. And that's why I have the pre-consultation, so I can get to know them. Because, you know, to me, there's nothing worse than having a client and you're playing around and doing a bunch of stuff and it's just not working because you don't have a game plan.
That's interesting, Craig, that you do have a pre-consult before a photo shoot. How long is the pre-consult for, typically?
It's not too long. You know, really, one of the, like, probably the number one reason for having a pre-consult is that, and this has happened to everybody, like, when you first get into this thing, you take everything. It doesn't matter because, you know, you're just happy to have a client.
Right.
And there's some clients that you take that you should have never taken. Right. And those are the major headaches. And so for me, I'm at the point where that pre-consult will weed those people out. Like, I'm not concerned with them being my client as much at, or, I mean, as me being their client as them being mine at this point. And so when I meet them, if we just don't jive or something's off, mm-hmm. I'll bail from it. You know, I'll just tell them, I'll say, you know, I think I can't reach your expectations and that I'm probably not the best fit for you. Mm-hmm. But I have these friends that might be better.
Indeed.
And that's really what I do in the consult, is it's really weeding people out that you don't want to work with.
Would you recommend that for a photographer who's just starting out though?
Because it's hard to pass up money and it's hard to pass up opportunity, but you know, why would you take business? This is going to be a pain in your ass. You know, there's no difference to it. You know, why not just not have headaches and have good experiences?
That might be a tweetable tweet right there. Yeah. why should you take clients who are going to be a pain in the ass? Tell us a little bit about your post-production, because you started out your career as a Photoshop retoucher or editor, I'm assuming, and then you've really played with light and also Photoshop editing now, right? I mean, is that's sort of a mix of things that you do?
Yeah. So the reason, and I think the reason why I was able to get to the level that I am in the amount of time that I got there was because of my graphics background. Like I said, I was a graphic artist for probably 12 years before I ever picked a camera up. Mm-hmm. You know, I knew that I could edit. And so when I started shooting, it was just a matter of learning how to shoot. And to me, you know, and this is great, a lot of people like are, you know, straight out of the camera people, and that's wonderful and all, but that's not what I do. I tell everyone, you know, I'm in, when you come to me, you're really living, we're in fantasy land, you know. You don't come to me if you want, you know, totally realistic pictures. Like, you're still going to look like yourself. And it's what I call shine the penny. I tell people, okay, you're going to come in, and what I'm going to do to you is I'm going to take all the rust off. I'm going to polish you all up, and I'm going to make you amazing. You're still going to be you, but that's what I do. If you want images that look exactly the way you are, well, you know, grab your phone and take a picture, because that's not what I'm here to do. And so with the editing and stuff, it came pretty easy, but I wanted to take it to another level. So I actually took advanced retouching class just because I really love retouching. I think that in my head, retouching and editing are two whole different monsters. You know, they're two different disciplines, and you either really like it or you really don't.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to get more into the retouching side of things than I did the editing.
Who did you take the class from? I'm sorry to interrupt.
I took it from, I can never pronounce her name. She owns Omaha Image Productions. It's Julia, and I always screw this up.
I know who you're talking about. I think I know who you're talking about. So
she's gonna kill me if she sees this too. So. Damn you for asking me that. I thought that would come up. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm not going to be able to pronounce her name.
Don't worry about that. I mean, it's really, I'm going to link to her. I think that's going to be how you're going to redeem yourself right here, because I'm going to link to her website and say, hey, learn retouching from Julia, right?
Yeah, well, she actually doesn't do one. Like, I was lucky enough at the time that she did one-on-ones, and so I took a one-on-one from her.
Oh, okay.
She has literature and books that she does. And, in fact, they're pretty good books. They're actually really good books.
And her website is Omaha Image Productions. Is that right?
Yeah, Omaha Image Productions.
Okay. I'm looking it up right here, right now. Indeed. Well, I will link to it, and hopefully she'll be thankful to you for spreading the word. Let's talk a little bit about your use of Facebook, because it has been huge for you, and and you use it like nobody's business. And I think when we were talking before we started recording, in fact yesterday when we first talked, you suggested that it was predominantly responsible for your ascendance in this business in the last couple of years, last few years. So tell us a little about how you use Facebook and what do you do? What your advice would be for other photographers who are looking to use Facebook as a way to promote themselves and help other people, not just photographers, other people understand more about their business.
So for me, how it worked, like everything, I got to tell you, man, like nothing was really by design. It just kind of, I've really lucked out, but it's a formula that has worked really well. Because when I got into the business, like I literally knew nothing about the business side of photography at all. Mm-hmm. And so, and I really didn't know a lot about Facebook. It was when I got into photography is when I actually got into Facebook. Mm-hmm. And so what happened was, you know, I was shooting, you know, boudoir at the time, and I wasn't really happy with boudoir. And so one of my friends actually sent me a link to Sue Bryce's, some of her artwork, and not like the Creative Live big flower stuff, but like her fine art stuff. And I was like, whoa, that's really awesome. And so on Facebook, I was looking up Sue Bryce and I came across her group In Bed with Sue Bryce. Mm-hmm. And so then I joined that group, and then, you know, I joined Jennifer Rosenbaum's group. You know, and at first, you know, I'd see all these people and they were posting pictures, and the pictures inside their groups were basically like copycat pictures, you know, trying to, you know, pay homage to, you know, Sue or to whatever. And I just started posting my own pictures. You know, while they were kind of in her style, they you know, they weren't, you know, Sue pictures. Mm-hmm. And so I would just keep posting and keep posting, and then people, you know, started to take notice of the work. And so then I'm like, So I started joining all these Facebook groups, and I would put pictures in all these groups, and I would just like constantly just start flooding the internet with my images. And, you know, in the beginning, I would get like, hey, you know, you're posting too many pictures, blah, 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 you know, do this, do that. And I'm like, okay. So I keep posting more pictures, you know? And so from that, maybe about a year and a half into it, then the call started coming up. You know, people going, hey, you know, do you teach? I really like your style. Do you do this? Do you do that? And I'm like, no. Because I never planned on being an educator. Like, right. I really did. Mm-hmm. And then after so long of it coming, I was finally put on. I'm like, okay. I was going to go to Las Vegas with Stacy for a conference. And so I thought, well, I'll just put one on because I'm going to be there anyway. And if it does well, great. And if it doesn't, then I guess great. And it didn't. I got about five people. But it was a fantastic learning experience for me, you know, to find out how exactly to do these things.
Right.
And then I put more of them on. And the first ones were really, you know, didn't get a lot of participation. And then they finally just took off as more people started seeing them, you know, they really took off. And, you know, kind of going back to the Facebook thing, it's like, cause like I said, I'm in the middle of Idaho. Like there's no one here. There's really not a lot of art here. And so for me, Facebook was really a release, because I wanted people to see my imagery. And I don't know if that's, you know, narcissistic or what, but I love people to look at my images. And so that's why I would post them all over Facebook and all over everywhere, is because I wanted people to see what I could do. And a lot of it is like, you know, I was a football coach for about 15 years.
Ah.
And so I am super, super competitive. And I gotta phrase this right, or it's going to come off bad and I'm going to get blasted. But like, you know, photography and art isn't a competition, you know, because it's so subjective.
Right.
But in my crazy head, it is a competition. Like, like, I want to, and I don't mean this in a bad way, like, I want to be better than Sue Bryce, or I want to be better than, than blah, blah. But at the same time, like, I want my images to be on the same level as them, like I really do. And so that's what I push myself to be, is to just get to the level of those people who I admire. Mm-hmm. And it's really, the competition part is more about admiration than it is about trying to be better than them. Because no way I'd want to do that, because I admire them so much.
Right.
But the same level, it's you know, like, there's nothing for me. And this is the other crazy thing about Facebook. You know, there's so many people on there when they post their images, or there's so many people that bash their images and blah, blah, and nitpick and all this other crap. And it's just crazy to me, you know, that people just don't appreciate other people's work.
Right.
You know, and to me, I love seeing people's work who's just way beyond me at this point. Because number one, it's awesome, because I know what they've had to do to get to that level.
I don't mean to put you on the spot, but who would you say meets that criteria for you?
Oh, gosh, jeez, man, that's a hard one.
Name names.
Oh, now I go blank with things. Let me think.
Let me put it. Yeah, go on.
Okay, so the people who really drive me, I don't know if you've ever been on 500 Pixels.
I have.
Okay, so 500 Pixels is where I go to really get charged up, because so I'm an 80s kid, so I was born in the 80s. So when I say Russians, I encompass everyone on that side of the planet, like whether it's German or it's Czech or whatever. So when I got on 500 Pixels, I would see those Europeans work, or those Russians work, and their work is so crazy awesome. Like, it's so much, to me, stronger and better than what portraiture is here. That it just has a different feel. It has it's grittier, it's neater, and it's so strong. And so I would look at all those guys' work, and that's what really pushed me. It's like, oh man, I got to get to that level. Like, it's amazing. Like if you go on 500 Pixels and you look at a portraiture from the guys in the different countries, it's so crazy. And that's what it is.
Absolutely. Cool.
I know I kind of skated around that, but
no, that's fine. That's a good way for people to explore 500 Pixels and see what's out there, because I mean the photography there is phenomenal, no doubt about it. Tell us, you've sort of hinted at workshops, and I know you do them now, and I know you've got a few coming up in Dallas, September 13th and 14th, Tucson, October 10th and 11th, and the biggest one that I'm really excited about is that you're coming to Connecticut, where I live, and that's going to be September 22nd for the CTPPA group. In Hartford. Man, I tell you, I can't wait for you to be here, because it's going to be phenomenal.
Thank you.
What motivates you to teach now, though? What is it that you feel you're ready to do for other people to say, well, Craig Lemire's work is phenomenal, I want to learn to photograph like him, or light like him, or post-process like him? What is it that they're coming to you for?
Okay, well, most people come for, well, you know, they come for the lighting and the post stuff. A lot of them come for the post. But really, what really excites me about teaching is the same thing that got me excited about coaching. Like, I love coaching more than anything.
Mm-hmm.
And what I like about teaching at this point now is you get these photographers in here, and, you know, you're basically just showing them what you did to get to where you are. And I tell everyone, there's a million ways to skin a cat. There's no right way to do something. This is just the way that I found to do it. And it's really cool to take people, and because, you know, they invest a lot of time and they invest a lot of energy, and so it's cool to show them something they're like, oh my gosh, I never would have thought of that. Or you know what? I always, you know, I had that concept, but it never all came together, and you're able to show it to me and make it make sense. And that's exciting to me. And the other thing that's really cool about the workshops is every group in the end seems like a little family. It's so weird what happens in the 2 days that we're together, because my workshops are long. Like Charlotte, we went from 9 a.m. till 1 a.m.
Wow.
And so you're with these people for that amount of time, and you're in there and you're shooting and you're drinking and you're eating and you're having fun. and everyone lets their guard down. And what's cool is the groups are so diverse. You know, I mean, you have engineers, you have moms, you have, you know, professional photographers, you have, you know, lawyers, doctors, you know, just, and all of these people with these varied backgrounds that found some commonality in mm-hmm. what it is that I do to draw them. And so you get all these people that come together, but the commonality is that they enjoy, I guess, what I produce. And so then everyone just gels and flows and grows together. It's freaking awesome, man. Excellent. And like, I will say this, the thing that turned the corner for the teaching was something Jennifer Rosenbaum told me. Like, we don't, you know, we don't talk a lot or anything, but when we do, she always tells me these things that stick with me forever. Like, you know, I was talking to her about when I first wanted to really get into education, and she was, you know, said, you know, what will make you different? You know, there's a million people out there that take pretty pictures. You know, what is it that you have to offer these people? Because to be very honest with you, when I first started, I had no problem teaching lighting. I thought, I'll teach lighting, but I was going to hold back the editing because in my head, like, oh, the editing's mine. You know, I'm not going to let anyone have it. And that's really stupid. And then after that talk, it clicked into me that, you know, the cost of the workshop is X. But then there's time away from your family that's X. There's buying an airplane ticket. There's all this other stuff. And so you've invested a lot of money to come listen to me. And you're coming to see me because you really believe that I have something to offer you that's either going to take your art or your business to the next level. Right. And if I was to hold stuff back when people would invest that much into me, I would be, you know, I want to say bad cuss words right now, but I wouldn't be a very good person.
Right.
And so that's when it hit me that you have to give people everything that you have. Like, and that's what happens when you come to workshop. Like, and at times I think it's too much because I'm very like I'm a big spaz when I teach and when I shoot. Like, you'll see it. Like I get going big time. And so sometimes I kind of have to curtail a little bit and remember not everyone's obviously at the level I'm at. So the things I'm sending them may be going, so I got to hold back. But but that's what motivates me. That's what gets me excited is the whole, you know, teaching and them getting excited and them finally letting their guard down and going for it, you know. And, you know, one thing you hear in this thing that really drives me nuts is I hate the hand-holding that goes on. You know, there's so many people, and this is hard for me because, you know, because like I said, because of coaching.
Yeah.
You know, people are like, oh, I just don't know if I'm good enough, you know, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, then you're not. You're not going to make it. You know, I mean, this is like this business is freaking tough. And I would have never thought it. Like, when I first got into it, I'm not kidding, man. I thought, if you take pretty pictures, you will beat off clients with a stick. And that's how stupid I was. And it's really about marketing yourself, branding yourself, finding your customer, you know, and, you know, finding out what you have to charge people by understanding true costs of what it is to really do business.
Right.
And so all those things kind of go into it. And if you, to me, aren't even secure enough in taking the pictures, you're never going to be able to run the business. You know, so I try to really push and impress on people, you know, you have to have a self-belief like nothing else. Like, nothing can divert you from your goals, or nothing that comes to you can shake that foundation you have in yourself, that you have to believe that all things are possible if you just can get through it, if you can just do it, you know. And the other thing is with this, I really get upset with people about is, and you know, I did it in the beginning, we all do it, but our clients aren't guinea pigs, you know, that you need to practice what you're doing, not when someone pays you to do it, but before that. So when someone comes to you as a client and they say, hey, you know, can you shoot this family portrait this way, that you can say and be honest, go, yeah, no problem. Right. Versus going, oh, yeah, sure I can. As soon as I go, you're on your Facebook group going, oh, I just booked this client and they want this. I don't know how the shit to do it. Can someone tell me how? I just want to just strangle them. You know, I'm just like, you took their money and you don't even know what you're doing. Come on.
Yes, indeed.
So, you know, it's stuff like that, and that's the kind of stuff at the workshop. It's not just teaching them lighting. It's, you know,
yeah.
I just want to kind of, you know, just push them. Just push them to be the best that they can be. You know, just go for it, you know. you know, when you talk about style and stuff, and to me that comes from, it's just shooting. You know, in fact, I was having a conversation last night about this, you know, and I tell the people, this is my analogy for it. I say, if you're a woodworker and you build a chair only when somebody orders one, you're going to have shitty chairs and you're not going to be a woodworker very long. So if the only time that you're shooting pictures is when someone buys them, you're going to be a crappy photographer and you're not going to be one very long. You know, so go out and practice your craft, you know. So
that's,
you know,
that's great advice. Great advice. Craig, thank you so much. I could talk to you for like hours, man. Really, it's just phenomenal. Thank you for your words, and thanks for telling us a little bit about yourselves. And I sincerely mean it. September 22nd is like is a go for me, and I am not going anywhere except coming to your workshop, your presentation with CTPPA, and that's going to be phenomenal. I know other folks are going to love it as well. Given your background as a football coach for 15 years, you said, and
oh, yeah.
And you know, you're not just a guy who takes pictures and sort of presents it. You're about also working the magic behind the scenes with the business, which is really something that is amazing. You know, I think in this day and age, as you rightly said, you can't just have pretty pictures on your site and not have a business behind it. It's, you're going to go flat, you know? And I think that's my takeaway from you today, is that work on both, and definitely keep practicing photography, because that's the only way you're going to get better. Thank you so much for joining us today, Craig.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.